Hello, and welcome to Worship with Christ Church United Methodist in Tucson. I am Pastor Beth, and I am so glad you have joined us for worship today. I have a few announcements. The season of Lent is upon us. No, no, not the stuff from your dryer or the time when you return all the things lent to you by others, but the 40 days of preparation for Jesus' death and resurrection. On Wednesday, February 17th, Christ Church will be celebrating our Ash Wednesday service live on Zoom at 6:30 p.m. Arizona time. If you want to join us, simply go to our website at ccumtucson.org and click the link for the service and take some time to look at our Lenten resources available there. Finally, we are celebrating communion today in this worship service, as well as our live communion service at 11 a.m. on February the 7th on Zoom. So please take a moment to find something to eat and drink in memory of all God has done for us in Christ. And remember, in the Methodist Church, all are welcome at God's table, and all means all. Now, let us worship together.
Tops and valley floors, you reveal to us the light of your love. Our heart's desire is to bask in the amazing glory of the divine presence. With each encounter, we are changed and transformed. Draw us nearer, that we might receive the double portion of your Holy Spirit. Help us, O Holy One, to live our lives as a reflection of divine glory. May we walk among our brothers and sisters as a blessing, bearing light into dark places, hope to displace despair, and love that casts out hate. Our world is hurting, and we need the followers of Jesus to follow more closely. Maybe then we will hear your voice speaking to us and say, "Listen to my children, the beloved. Amen." This morning comes from Matthew 16, verses 13 to 17:9. Now when Jesus came into the district of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, "Who do people say that the Son of Man is?" And they said, "Some say John the Baptist, others Elijah, and still others Jeremiah or one of the prophets." He said to them, "But who do you say I am?" Simon Peter answered, "You are the Messiah, the Son of the living God." And Jesus answered him, "Blessed are you, Simon, son of Jonah, for flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my Father in heaven. And I tell you, you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of Hades will not prevail against it. I will give you the keys to the kingdom of heaven, and whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven." Then he sternly ordered the disciples not to tell anyone that he was the Messiah. From that time on, Jesus began to show his disciples that he must go to Jerusalem and undergo great suffering at the hands of the elders and chief priests and scribes, and be killed, and on the third day be raised. And Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him, saying, "God forbid it, Lord. This must never happen to you." But he turned and said to Peter, "Get behind me, Satan. You are a stumbling block for me, for you are setting your mind not on divine things, but on human things." Then Jesus told his disciples, "If you want to become my followers, let them deny themselves and take up their cross and follow me. For those who want to save their life will lose it, and those who lose their life for my sake will find it. For what would it profit them if they gain the whole world, but they forfeit their life? Or what will they give in return for their life? For the Son of Man is to come with his angels in the glory of his Father, and then he will repay everyone for what has been done. Truly I tell you, there are some standing here who will not taste death before they see the Son of Man coming to his kingdom. 6 days later, Jesus took with him Peter and James and his brother John and led them up to a high mountain by themselves. And he was transfigured before them, and his face shone like the sun, and his clothes became dazzling white. Suddenly there appeared to them Moses and Elijah talking to him. Then Peter said to Jesus, Lord, it is good for us to be here. If you wish, I will make three dwellings, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah. While he was still speaking, suddenly a bright cloud overshadowed them, and from a cloud a voice spoke, This is my Son, the Beloved. With him I am well pleased. Listen to him. When the disciples heard this, they fell to the ground and were overcome by fear. But Jesus came and touched them and saying, Get up and do not be afraid. And when they looked up, they saw no one except Jesus himself alone. As they were coming down the mountain, Jesus ordered them, Tell no one about the vision until after the Son of Man has been raised from the dead.
Thank you.
you say that I am? This is the haunting question that the Spirit of God whispers into the soul of any of us following Jesus. From the first inner circle of 12 disciples to the billion people who claim Christianity as their spiritual home today, this is the question we answer with our lives, the way we live, how we understand and interpret death, and what we believe about the mystery of life beyond death. Jesus poses this question to each of his disciples, learning the teachings, teaching the learnings, walking in the footsteps of those who first followed the Son of Man, Son of God, Lord, Messiah, Emmanuel, Christ, Savior. Jesus asks each of us this question because, as he declares with Simon, his rock, Peter, our answer to this question lays the foundation upon which the church, not our building or our ritualized practices of faith, but our community and our communal living in faith, it is upon this that the church is built. Peter is not the only rock. Peter is the model of how each of us might be the living stones upon which the temple of grace, love, and compassion, the very kingdom of God, is built. So I want to tell you my transfiguration story. And at first, it's going to sound a bit like a conversion story, but the truth is, the transfiguration story is the time when our eyes are opened and our hearts are opened, and we see clearly who Jesus is. That moment can come for any of us at any time in our lives. And when it does come, either in a quiet realization or in a day-to-day revelation of understanding, or perhaps in some kind of dramatic conversion experience, we know that something in us has changed. For me, it was 2009, which feels like forever ago, and I was standing at the crossroads of my life and faith journey. I was a third-year seminary student serving as a pastoral intern at Trinity United Methodist Church in downtown Atlanta, Georgia. Graduation was 2 months away, and I had already applied to the Desert Southwest Conference for an appointment as a local pastor because I'd taken a scholarship from this conference to attend seminary. And in doing so, I had promised this conference the first 4 working years of my ministry out of seminary. But I had a really big problem. When my professors, parishioners, prospective employers asked me who Jesus was to me, my answer was, he was an amazing man who changed the world, a rabbi, a political dissident and nonviolent activist who advocated on behalf of the poor and oppressed and was executed by the Roman government. Jesus was a teacher who modeled for all who followed him how to live and who has inspired 2,000 years of religious movements known collectively as the church. I am sure many of you heard some of your own answer in there. And if you were listening carefully, there were some very clear things that you did not hear. I had deep respect for the power and teachings of the church. I could speak the language of faith with the best of them because I had grown up in the church. But I will tell you, faith in Jesus, I didn't have it. Not the faith of the disciples, not the faith I knew the church would be asking me to confess if I wanted to continue in ministry. Jesus was the Son of God to me, the way we all are children of God. Jesus was the Messiah, the way the first century Jewish, Greco-Roman world understood the term Messiah. In the words of my Southern Baptist grandfather, I was definitely not a believer. And that had been just fine for my entire life. But I was on the verge of a vocation that required more than an intellectual understanding of who Jesus was. I couldn't imagine presiding at a communion table or sitting with people before doing a memorial service without being able to clearly believe in this Jesus who I was asked to teach about. It came to a head when my pastoral supervisor, the Reverend Kathy Morris of Trinity, assigned me and my pastoral intern partner to preach the Easter Sunday sermon. I flat out told her, I can't preach on the resurrection because I do not believe in it. And she offered me this wisdom that changed my life. Well, Beth, you better figure that out because I'm not asking, and Easter is in a month. So I did what any God-fearing third-year seminary student would do when faced with an impossible task. I prayed on my knees. God, you called me here. You have opened every door I have stepped through. You have walked me to this point. If my path is into the church as a minister, let me meet Jesus. Teach me what it means to believe in Jesus Christ as the Messiah, as Emmanuel, God with us. And guess what? Nothing happened. I mean, nothing happened. Weeks passed, and every day I prayed the same prayer. I read everything I could get my hands on about the resurrection. In fact, I got so desperate, I watched every movie about the passion that I could, from Godspell to Jesus Christ Superstar to The Passion. I spoke to my professors, my peers, my former pastors, even the people I was serving, my parishioners. It was like I was Peter, James, and John all rolled into one, stuck on the mountain, watching Jesus speaking to Elijah and Moses. I could see who and what Jesus was in that moment of conversation. I could intellectually understand what I was seeing. But when it came to faith, I was stuck in this cloud, hearing God's voice, but unable to experience that transfiguration of Jesus from simple mortal man to fully God and fully human. And then the dreaded day came, Holy Saturday, that day before Easter, Resurrection Sunday, and our church was holding an Easter vigil, and I would be presiding at the table and preaching part of that sermon. The sermon was written, after all, I had aced resurrection theology at Candler, but as I rode into Atlanta that evening to open the church for our service, I still hadn't met Jesus. I didn't believe in this Jesus Christ I was being asked to preach about. And it was about 9 p.m. when I arrived at the doors of the church. The moonlight had turned that hard, dirty city into this glittering ghost world of shadow. And that strange light the moon reflects from the sun was turning everything silvery. The grinding poverty of the city was on display that night. You could smell it in the smell of urine that rose up from the garden planter because there were no public restrooms in the city. You could see it in the people who were sleeping on our steps because they knew they wouldn't be arrested. We welcomed them there. It was in the abandoned buildings that the economic crash of 2008 had shuttered. And as I stepped by one of my sleeping brothers, he woke up and caught my arm. Pastor, he asked, what's happening? And I said, well, it's our Easter vigil. We are going to wait for the resurrection tonight, I said. And he, in the genuine sincerity of faith that he had, in all the excitement he could muster, shouted, praise God. I stood there, hand on the door, keys in the lock, his words ringing in my ears, and I closed my eyes. Jesus, I prayed, your people are hungry and homeless. We have nothing left to offer them, so get here, save us. Take this broken, hurting world and bring about that kingdom you are always preaching of. We need you now. And as I opened my eyes, unlocking and opening that ancient church door, as my brothers and sisters who had been sleeping on the steps woke up, came inside, warmed up, ate the food we had for them, sat in the shelter of our community, I found myself face to face with Jesus. In the mission of the church, in the hope of the homeless disciples eating with me, in the mystery of the worship we did, in the power of faith to declare praise God in the worst of times. Suddenly, Jesus was more than just this amazing man. Jesus was God's own son, who reveals the deepest call of our lives, the deepest power of God to change the world, the truest purpose. Jesus, the one I hear and follow. Even today, the transfiguration of my own faith journey in that mysterious moonlit moment on the steps of that church haunts me with the Holy Spirit power of God. It is what has kept me on the path and in the church during the decades since that time. When I read these verses from Matthew, from Jesus' question to his disciples, "Who do you say that I am?" to Jesus' rebuke of Peter, his own rock, his foundation, not to hinder the work of God, but rather to assume the position of discipleship. "Get behind me, follow me to the cross and beyond." When I read that mysterious story of the transfiguration, Jesus, the reminder that God has God's own time for the revelation of who Jesus is for each of us. It is like I am there on those steps all over again, praying with all the passionate sincerity of a young 20-something-year-old, for God to come now and change the world, realizing that Emmanuel, God, is with us now. God is here already working in our hands, in our hearts, in our hopes. We don't need some mysterious mountaintop experience to transform the world. We just need to meet Jesus in the everyday of our lives, in the sincerity of our prayers. And that reminds me that Jesus asks each of us, as we are on this journey, "Who do you say that I am?" And it is our calling and identity to seek after that answer. Amen.
God of transformation, we come together as those who have met you on the mountaintop. We have each had our holy encounters with you, and in those moments we have wanted to stay on the mountain and retreat from the world. We know that this is our longing, not yours. So as we offer our gifts this morning in response to your blessings in our life, remind us that our mission is the world beyond the mountain, our daily living and being. Transfigure our lives to the memories of those mountaintop encounters so that we may declare everywhere that Jesus Christ is here. We pray boldly in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you. is here in our midst.
We celebrate and rejoice in the presence of God.
It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to rejoice and give thanks to you, God, creator of heaven and earth. Before the mountains were brought forth, or the earth formed, from everlasting to everlasting, you are God. You created light out of darkness and brought forth life on this earth. You formed us in your image and breathed into us the breath of life. When we tried to build monuments to false ideas or got stuck in our own small ways, your grace remained steadfast. You delivered us from captivity, made covenant to be our sovereign God, and spoke to us through your prophets. And so, with your people on earth and all the vast company of creation, we praise your name and join their unending hymn, saying together,
Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest.
Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ, in whom you have revealed yourself, our light, our salvation. You are the one who calls us back to our right minds, and through Christ walk with us on the hardest roads. Transfigured before our very eyes, you named your Son your beloved child, your own pleasure. A reminder that this love is inheritance to all of us who seek your grace. We remember on the night before Jesus gave himself up and died for us, he gathered his friends together around a table like this. He took bread, he gave thanks to you, blessing that bread. Then he took it and broke it and offered it to his disciples, saying, Take, eat, all of you. This is my body given for you. As often as you eat, eat in remembrance of me. And then when the supper was over, Christ took the cup, gave thanks to you, and then offered it to each of his disciples, saying, Drink from this, all of you, for this is the cup of the new covenant, poured out for you and for all for the forgiveness of sins. As often as you drink, drink in remembrance of me. And so, in remembrance of these your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we declare this mystery of faith.
Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
Pour out your Holy Spirit on all of us gathered in this unique way to share this blessed meal wherever we are. We ask that you make our food and drink that same love and grace that was given by Christ so that we might be redeemed, our lives transfigured by your love and grace. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other wherever we are, and one in ministry to all the world until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet.
Through your Son
Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, as part of your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. Friends, because there is one God, we who are many, eating in different places, are one body, for we all share that same meal given to us by the living God. The drink and food over which we have given thanks is a sharing in God's covenant for all. As we eat and drink, we receive the gifts of grace and love from God. Wherever we are, let us feast on this love and grace now. Amen.
Take our bread, we ask you, take our
our lives. Oh, Father, we are yours. We are yours. Yours as we stand at the table you set. Yours as we eat the bread our hearts can't forget. We are the sign of your life with us yet. We are yours. We are yours. Take our bread, we ask you. Take our hearts, we love you. Take our lives, O Father, we are yours. We are yours.
And now, having been fed by God's love and grace, spiritually and physically, we come before you in thanksgiving and prayer, praying as Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
And now, my friends, receive this benediction. No matter where God meets us, God is for us. No matter where God leads us, God is with us. No matter what God asks of us, God will see us through. So let us be courageous in everything we do. Amen.